Hello and welcome. My name is Terry Young and I'm a member here at Glendora United Methodist Church. We are honored today to welcome the Reverend Betsy Strader as our guest preacher. Reverend Strader has just recently retired from the pastoral ministry after serving 37 years as the associate minister of Glenkirk Church here in the city of Glendora. During her years of service there, she was the leader in women's ministries and reached the hearts of thousands. She attended Whitworth College in Spokane, Washington, as well as Fuller Theological Seminary here in Southern California. Following ordination, she received her first call in the Presbyterian ministry as an associate youth pastor in Bend, Oregon. Family and friends are an important part of her life. In addition, she enjoys travel, golf, watching sports, and camping. From my experience and the long experience of my wife, Ruth, we have found Betsy to be a dynamo, a do-it-now woman. And we are very pleased to have Reverend Strader with us today, bringing us the word. So then, as we worship together this day, may we continue to rejoice in the power of the resurrection, to be encouraged in our spiritual journeys, and find great hope for the days ahead. Let us join in worship.
Welcome. Please join me in the responsive call to worship. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. In our anguish, we cried to the Lord, and He answered by setting us free. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. The Lord is our strength and our song. He has become our salvation. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. We will not die, but live, and will proclaim what the Lord has done. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. From the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. The believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the community, to their shared meals, and to their prayers. A sense of awe came over everyone. God performed many wonders and signs through the apostles. All the believers were united and shared everything. They would sell pieces of property and possessions and distribute the proceeds to everyone who needed them. Every day they met together in the temple and ate in their homes. They shared food with gladness and simplicity. They praised God and demonstrated God's goodness to everyone. The Lord added daily to the community those who were being saved.
Thank you. Would you join me in prayer? Almighty God, by your power, you raised Jesus from the dead. We humbly confess that while we know and believe the story, too often it has made too little difference in our lives. We have not lived as resurrection people. We have not allowed it to transform our lives. We've been silent when we should have shared your good news. We ask for forgiveness, for allowing our reason to determine the strength of our faith. Make us people whose lives are forever defined by your cross and resurrection. We thank you for your forgiveness, your new life. Come, Spirit, come. Be in our midst, transform us. Make us like Jesus. Speak to us. Guide us. Lord, we give you the things that are heaviest on our hearts, the people we love who are suffering, the decisions we need to make, that bad news we heard about this week. Bring your resurrection power into these situations. But Lord, we also need you to give us wisdom in a world that is so far from you. Thank you for the assurance that you have not let go, that you are working. But help us know how to love on those who are angry. And may our conversations be filled with your peace and love. Lord, guide our leaders. Lord, may those who know you have the courage to reach across divisions and work together in your name for that which is best. And Lord, as the news seems to bring one catastrophe after another into our living rooms, we ask that you would give us wisdom, love, and gifting to help us know how to pray. And Lord, that you would give wisdom and love to those who are able to help. Jesus, we also lift up those who have so much less than we do. Help us know how you might be calling us to love on them. You do not call us to take on all the world's problems, but help us know where you want us to individually use what you have given us to love on the least of these. Jesus, thank you for never leaving or forsaking us. Thank you for standing in the gap, for providing for us, for teaching us, especially for teaching us how to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The offerings we give empower ministries within our congregation and of our community and even beyond. Our offerings support the work of ministries that reach people who are in desperate need to feel a touch of God's love and reconciliation. Through our connectional giving, we engage, train, and resource generations of disciples who lead the church into the world. Let us gratefully give of our offerings in praise of Christ's ministry through us and for us. Loving and generous God, you have given us more than we could ever give you in return. You are gracious and generous in your love. Accept our offerings as signs of our gratitude and bless our work on Christ's behalf. May we love as Christ loved. May we serve as Christ served. Call us forth into your world and guide us always by the Spirit of your resurrected Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The gospel reading for today is from John 1, verses 1 through 18. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was with God in the beginning. Everything came into being through the Word, and without the Word, nothing came into being. What came into being through the Word was life. And the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness doesn't extinguish the light. A man named John was sent from God. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, so that through him everyone would believe in the light. He himself wasn't the light, but his mission was to testify concerning the light. The true light that shines on all people was coming into the world. The light was in the world, and the world came into being through the light. But the world didn't recognize the light. The light came to his own people, and his own people didn't welcome him. But those who did welcome him, those who believed in his name, he authorized to become God's children. Born not from blood, nor from human desire or passion, but born from God. The Word became flesh and made his home among us. We have seen his glory, glory like that of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified about him, crying out, This is the one of whom I said, He who comes after me is greater than me, because he existed before me. From his fullness, we have all received grace upon grace, as the law was given from Moses. So grace and truth came into being through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. God, the only Son, who is at the Father's side, has made God known.
He is risen. He has risen indeed. It is good to be with all of you. I remember videoing a sermon once for Hillary to use in the midst of COVID, but that was before I retired. Now I find myself filling in now and then for pastors, helping with my denominational's local governing body, and leading a Bible study on the Gospel of John at Royal Oaks in Bradbury, where my mother lives, which is why today we are looking at the opening words of the Gospel of John. Oh, I have some fun too. I joined a women's golf group at San Dimas Canyon, just recently returned from a Disney cruise, and I had plans for a Grand Canyon trip and a Viking cruise this summer. Now, as we begin, let me ask a question. When God looks at you, what does he see? I mean, not how do you see yourself when you look in the mirror in the morning, but how does God see you? My brother, who's also a pastor, in every Sunday service somewhere works in the statement, God loves you, and there's absolutely nothing you can do about it. And I love that. God loves you, and there's absolutely nothing you can do about it. Oh, you can fight it and seek to ignore it, or seek to cause him pain by going your own way. But God loves you, and there's nothing you can do about it. John says that God's hope is that we become his children, born not out of our works or our doing, but out of our receiving him, believing in him, living in his light, to the life, grace, and power that he gives us by his Holy Spirit. When God looks at you, he sees his dearly loved child, perfectly created and precious beyond measure. Now, John is also the author of the book of Revelation, where he gives us another vision of how God sees us. There we are told that God sees us as his bride, beautifully adorned for her husband. You know, as a pastor, I get the best view in the house at weddings. I love it when that door opens and the bride starts to come down the aisle. But do you know what? I don't look at the bride. I look at the groom, who is often so overwhelmed with joy and love that they tear up. God sees you as his bride, as his child, with all the rights and privileges that go with being the child of the King, the bride of Jesus. Do you believe this? By the way, in the 22 chapters of John, John uses the word believe 98 times. And in each chapter, he points to the fact that Jesus is God. To believe is to stake one's life on a truth, to make it a reality in your life. The message of Good Friday and Easter is that if we choose to receive it, believe it, live into it, we are God's children, his bride. And because he is the all-powerful creator God of the universe, there's nothing that he will withhold from us, and nothing can get in the way of his love, care, presence, guidance. Nothing can defeat us, absolutely nothing. You know, on Easter, I heard a sermon filled with statements like, Jesus specializes in emptiness. He empties himself and goes to a cross. On Easter morning, his disciples are empty. Empty hearts, empty hope, empty tomb. But where there is empty, Jesus shows up and fills us with resurrection hope, love, power, and grace. We cannot fill ourselves, but Jesus came to not only forgive us, but fill us, giving us grace upon grace. Again, the question, do we believe it? Or do we listen to the accuser and all of his yes buts? Do we choose to live in the light of God's revealed truth and ways? Or would we rather live in darkness, giving into the ways of the world, the systems of the world and our culture, and what they have to say? Okay, another question. What is sin? I mean, my guess, if you were to answer that question, you would come up with a list of sins. Don't kill, don't lie, don't swear. But have you ever noticed that sin is actually singular in Scripture? Our list of sins are actually the symptoms of the existence of sin, singular. Kind of like having a cough and a temperature, a runny nose. They're symptoms of a cold. When I was in the ninth grade in communicants class, my pastor at the time taught us that sin is my playing God. Sin is my telling God, I don't need you. I can provide for myself. I know what is best. I can make decisions without you. Life revolves around me. Sin is taking things into my own hands rather than trusting in God and His knowing and wisdom and providing and timing, His work and gifting. Sin is choosing to walk in darkness rather than light. Now, John begins his prologue by taking us back to creation and Genesis 1. In fact, the first chapter and a half of John's gospel comprises 1 week. The first week in Jesus' ministry, kind of like the first week of creation. John begins talking about creation and ends the first week with a wedding feast. What John wants us to see is that God has a purpose to all of history. There's a beginning and an end. God created a beautiful, well-ordered, good world filled with His presence. But rather than choosing to live in God's light, Adam and Eve listened to the accuser, and the world fell into darkness. But God didn't give up. He immediately went to work. He killed an animal, making clothing, and then using that skin of the animal to cover their nakedness, pointing to what Jesus would do on a cross, covering our sin. The early chapters of Genesis show us the growth of evil. These chapters show us what happened when we walk in darkness, when we ignore God. I mean, to the extent that in chapter 6, verse 5, we read, "The Lord saw that humanity had become thoroughly evil on the earth, and that every idea their minds thought up was always completely evil." But God, in Genesis 12, calls Abraham out. He says to Abraham, "Abraham, leave your family, your land, everything that is familiar, and follow me to the land that I will show you." God makes a promise to Abraham that his descendants will be more numerous than the stars. He promises to bless him so that he would be a blessing to others. To Abraham's descendants through Moses, God gave the gift of the law, a grace gift. Because having just freed the Israelites from being enslaved, God basically was saying, this is how to live so that you do not become slaves again. The Passover and all the Jewish ritual all point to Jesus. They were gifts of grace, but they were all temporary solutions. Now, new grace has arrived. You see, the problem was that the Israelites could not keep the law. They kept blowing it, making selfish decisions, following the ways of the countries around them, rather than being set apart to live in the light God had given them. Now John is saying, with the coming of Jesus, the final solution to sin, evil, and darkness has come. It is as if God's kind of hitting that restart button, kind of like what we do when our cell phones stop working and we reboot them. By defeating the adversary on the cross, God is beginning again with a new creation that will be complete with His return, as we see in Revelation 21 and 22, when all darkness is gone and Jesus fully dwells with us in a new heaven and a new earth. That is where we're told that we're the bride of Christ. By putting the wedding feast at the end of the first week of Jesus' ministry, John is looking to the end, when the world is transformed, recreated, and filled with goodness and abundance that will never run out, but last into eternity. John wants us to see that God is working all things, all of history, to His final second coming, to see the new heaven and new earth, even when we don't understand it. I mean, even when we don't understand what God is doing or how he's doing it. I mean, remember, the disciples didn't get Good Friday. The light, Jesus, has come into the world to bring the world back into the light, into life. What John is saying here is that, one, that we should not be surprised with the existence of evil in the world. The light has come, but people would rather live in darkness. But the way to transform the darkness is to live in the light, to live like Jesus. You know, Rome eventually became a Christian empire, not through a revolution, but by Christians living sacrificial lives, seeking others out, giving their lives for others, loving and dying as Jesus did. But two, we don't have to live in darkness. If we desire, we can live in the light. We can be cleansed and transformed. You know, at the wedding feast in Cana, if you remember, the wine had run out, and Jesus went to work. He had the ritual cleansing jars filled with water. And then he transformed that water into the best wine ever. John is showing what Jesus wants to do in our lives if we would let him. Wash us clean and then transform our lives so that we would become like fine tasting wine to all who come close to us, that we would add flavor and joy to the lives of others. God gives us new grace, the grace of his Holy Spirit within us, transforming us that our lives would reflect Jesus to others. How are we doing? I mean, if you are like me, you can point out all the ways you've fallen short, but that is not how God sees us. Remember, we are God's children, becoming his bride. I mean, when your kids were growing up, at two, did you expect them to solve algebraic equations? Well, maybe at 15, but not at two. God is patient with us, but he also does not want us to remain two forever. Every morning is a new beginning in Jesus, a new opportunity to partner with him in the family business of taking his light, his life, his way of living and loving to those we come in contact with. Now, a third thing, God does not take evil lightly. I mean, there are consequences to walking in darkness. But what God does is take the consequences of evil onto himself. The evil, the pain, the hurt we cause, but also the evil and pain and hurt that others cause. You know, there's a price to pay for hurting others, for evil and sin, but God has paid it for us, but also for others. And we easily accept it for ourselves, but will we accept it for others who hurt us, forgiving them as we have been forgiven? Now, one of the things that we learn in the first chapter of John is that the religious leaders did not like John the Baptist. They kept questioning him as to why he was baptizing people and under whose authority. Now, John doesn't get into an argument with them. He just says, my job is twofold. One, to point to Jesus, and two, to decrease so that Jesus might increase. That's our job too, not to argue with people, but to point to Jesus, not making a name for ourselves, but letting others see Jesus in us, his forgiveness, his love, his power and grace. Let me recommend a book to you. It's called Stay Salt. Our world has changed, our message is not. It's by Rebecca Pippard. Just remember Stay Salt, and you can find it on Amazon. It is an incredibly easy read, but it is all about how we can have light-filled, hope-filled, grace-filled conversations that point people to Jesus, adding flavor to their lives. Again, incredibly easy read, lots of stories. It's called Stay Salt. Now, one final comment. When John says that everything came into being through the Word, and without the Word, nothing came into being, he's saying that nothing exists except by the will of Jesus. Paul says it this way in Colossians 1, all things were created by him, both in the heavens and on the earth, the things that are visible and the things that are invisible, whether they're thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. He existed before all things, and all things are held together in him. So briefly, everything comes from Jesus. You know, it's not my hard work that gets me ahead, that puts food on my table. It's not my exercising and eating well that gives me a long life. It all comes from Jesus. Yes, I'm to work and to exercise and take care of my body. Over and over again in Scripture, God calls us to be good stewards of the gifts that he's given to us. But there are people around the world today who work harder than I do, who are starving to death. This is not a sermon to get into all of that, other than to say that Jesus is the giver of all of life, and that the gifts he has given to us are grace gifts, given as a stewardship to be shared with others. We are to use our gifts, our resources, our lives to point to Jesus. Is that how you view your life, as a stewardship? You see, by reminding us that Jesus was the one who created all things, by reminding us that God has a purpose that he's working out, John is saying that we can trust God, his power, promises, and work, even when we do not yet understand what he is doing. And he's challenging us to walk in the light of God's love, sacrifice, and revelation, extending his light and life to others, rather than live in the darkness of the world's way of seeing things. How are we doing? Would you join me in prayer? Just sit for a minute with Jesus and ask Jesus, what are you trying to say to me personally? If you need forgiveness, ask him. And then believe you have it, that you are washed clean, the past is gone. And if you don't know Jesus, or if you're struggling, ask him to show himself afresh to you. Holy Spirit, come. Help us believe. Transform us, that we might be your light. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us join together in our Easter affirmation. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation.
Light of mine.
Now, as you go out into the week to live as resurrection people, taking God's light into the places you go, know that you do not go alone. The living and reigning Jesus goes with you. He goes behind you to comfort you, beside you to befriend you, within you to give you strength, above you to watch over you, and he goes before you to show the way. God bless you.